have in God and God alone. All of these things that we're looking at draw us to God. And thinking of it that way, Matthew 13, 44, let's say this first verse and then we'll say from Philippians 3 together. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. And then from Philippians chapter 3, it says, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. These verses give us great hope to hold to and to think upon and to meditate upon, and I encourage you to be memorizing them, and you'll see in our bulletin, Philippians 3:8 is the verse out of that passage that we're working on this week to hide in our hearts before the Lord. Well, 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'll begin reading in verse number 1 this morning, just for sake of context. This letter of Paul that he wrote, this is the last letter that Paul would have written before he was beheaded. And so it's a, you can say his last testament, his last words, his words of encouragement to a man that was taking one of the places that he had been serving, that he had raised up to pastor. And so these books are called, known today as the pastoral epistles of 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and next week we'll be in the third of those called Titus in chapter 3. But this morning, would you follow along as I read God's word to us, beginning in verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but share in suffering. For the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher and apostle and teacher, which is why I suffer as I do, but I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. And God, bless the reading of his word. Would you pray with me this morning? God, we are so grateful for the Jesus Christ, the plan before the foundation of the world, not secondary, but first. What a joy it is to know that you are Creator, who made us in your image. Apart from the rest of creation, we alone bear your image. There is no tree, there is no animal, there is no plant, there is no star, there is no moon, there is no sun that looks like you, like we do. And you have chosen that even when we chose intently to sin and go against your will, out of your great love, out of your power, you made us your own children through your Son, Jesus Christ, again. I thank you that we are not here today dressed in our good works, because we'd all be here today in filthy, grubby, dirty, stinky clothes. We're dressed, Jesus, as we're your children, trusting in you, in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, the one who has done every good work, who has faithfully followed and obeyed you and given his life as our sin bearer on the cross. This morning we want to see it is not by our works that we do that we are saved. You've created us for good works, we understand that, but it's not by them that we're saved. We're saved by faith alone, the gift that you've given to us in Jesus. Help us not to be confused about that this morning, Father. We pray, God, that you, as we have been reading, sharing in your sufferings and just all the hardships that we endure, that you would continue to be with our dear saints, whether it's Alice Beers, who's in Streetsboro now. Lord, I pray that you would be with her. Give her your strength as she recovers from this stroke that she's had recently. God, we pray as well that you'd continue to bring healing and restoration to so many that are still sick. Thank you that you are strength and that we, in our weakness, see your greatness and your provision. Spirit, we are thankful this morning that you guide us into truth and that you are here with us, making us alive as we have sung. You are the one that is empowering us to know and understand and see Jesus. And we ask that you would lead us to him this morning and that you would cause us, through the gift that you give us of faith, to trust him evermore. Cause our faith to grow, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Children through fourth grade, you're dismissed at this time for children's church. We find ourselves in very, very delicate times where things are changing ever constantly. Here today, gone tomorrow. The month of January has brought a change in the leadership of our nation, for which, as we've seen just a couple weeks ago, we need to be praying for and making part of our desire to see that we might lead a quiet and peaceful life, that the gospel can go forward. What's been interesting in this is that depending on what side that a person finds himself politically persuaded, is that they have been trying to use their powers that they think that they have to persuade others as well. I have literally given up on Facebook. It is a nightmare to watch people vomit their political views back and forth. What is really disturbing as well is then when people will attack a person's child. Or they will even then say, well, you know, your clothes were good enough for us at one point, and we really liked your clothing line, but now because of your affiliation with your father we're no longer going to buy your clothing. We are so fickle as people. Truth of the matter is, if you enjoy something, you should take delight in it. God has given us what we would call common grace. There is good things that God has given to us all to enjoy that he has made and that we get to delight in. I bring up Ivanka's clothing line because this morning we find ourselves in this series recognizing that we're clothed not in anything good that we have done, not in Ivanka's best apparel, but you and I are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. And I want you to see this morning how important it is for you and I as Christians and those desiring to seek after God to recognize this morning, I have something so much better than any money could ever buy that does not depend upon market value. It is bound up inclusively in Jesus. And we've come in this series so far to see that there are six, and I caution you with six because historically there's five, and it's not original with me. I have added a sixth one at the end that is I cannot take claim for, but it works well in our series, and I'll get to that in a moment. But we have the five solas, or the alone statements, that came out of the Reformation saying, this is what it means to be a child of God. This is what the Scriptures teach us. And so we saw, first of all, God's Word or Scripture alone. There is no other authority that we need, no other traditions of men that can stand in the place of God's Word. And so it is God's Word alone which we find our confidence in. It is Jesus Christ, then, alone, and not any other combination of any other person, but in particular, it's not the cooperation of Jesus Christ and me for my salvation. In other words, we'll see this morning as we go through this, that it is only dependent exclusively upon the work of Christ and not your works to be a child of God. And this morning then we'll look at this third one of faith alone. Faith alone stands apart from works. Now we're going to talk about this delicate balance and the misunderstandings that happen between faith and works this morning, but we'll come away seeing that faith alone is the only way that we acquire salvation. And then next week we'll look at grace alone, not anything that you and I have done to merit it or to deserve it. And then we'll look at then the last of the five souls, glory to God alone. All glory as a result of this should go and be directed to God. And then we'll conclude the series with an extra one that I think is pertinent to us in our day as we celebrate 500 years later. We need to hold these things in love alone, and we need to celebrate them, and we need to show them to the world, not in a spirit of hostility, but in a spirit of pointing people to the loving nature of God and how we as his children are his beloved, and he is being calling them into the beloved. And so this morning we look at faith alone. Now I must confess one thing to you this morning. We will not spend an incredible lot of time in our text this morning. I'm not going to exegete or exposit particularly all of it to you, but I do want to point out to you the importance of faith in this context, and I want you to also see in the light of the faith that Timothy is being called to hold to, also his timidity, his weaknesses, his fears, and how that his security in Christ Jesus as his God and Savior is not dependent upon how much faith or lack of faith he has at the moment. Now, there's two ways that we can go with this. And I want you to be very careful this morning. We're going to walk a very fine line today. If you've ever heard this before, I'm going to be on a razor's edge this morning, and give me license that next week I may come back and correct myself if I go off. Because I want you to know what we're talking about today is one of those things that you and I need to know precisely. It's going to have some detail to it, but the first thing of it is this. It is faith alone, and it is not by any works that I could do or a tribute to go along with the work of Jesus Christ upon the cross that brings salvation to me. There is nothing I can do to add to it. On the other side of this delicate issue, though, is this understanding that faith is somehow residing within me, and it's something that I muster up and I build up this feeling, if you will, emotively. And so then my Christianity is completely dependent at that point on how the day is going or the week is going or how I'm struggling or not struggling. And it's a very dangerous ground, because what happens at that point is it's just as dangerous as faith and works. I'm working at this point saying my works have to be going along with Jesus, but at this point I'm also saying that I'm working to try to be faithful or to show faith in some form or fashion. We would still call it self-justification. I want you to see here in our text that the man whom God has said is the apostle to the Gentiles knows that his life is coming to an end. Would you look with me in 2 Timothy chapter 4, and I'll show you this. Verse number 6, he's using Old Testament language when he says this. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. He recognizes, like in the Old Testament, they would offer sometimes, in addition to their sacrificial animal sacrifices, a drink offering. Now, any time that you pour something out, as the old adage goes, don't cry over spilled milk. Once it's spilled out, there's no going back. His life is being poured out. And when the pitcher is empty, it's over. My life is being poured out as a drink offering, and I'm okay with that, because I know, as we've seen here in chapter 1 at the end of our reading, I know whom I've believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep me for that day. He doesn't know necessarily how his life is going to end, but the matter is that Paul recognizes in some form or fashion that his ministry, his life, is coming to an end. And quite frankly, there's nothing wrong with that. In the book of Philippians, he puts it this way. It's my desire to depart and to be with Christ. And can I say to us all here, whether we're young or old, there is nothing wrong with dying as a Christian. Yes, there is that mourning. Yes, there is that grieving of losing that person whom we can touch. But the scriptures teach us so clearly, to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord, and do not cry the day that I die. I will be so alive in Jesus, and so will you if you're in Christ. There is nothing to fear at that point. Now, has Paul shared the gospel with every Gentile nation yet? No, he hasn't. Are there things still to take place? Absolutely. And what's he doing in this book is he's entrusting this to a man named Timothy. And if you look at it, Timothy is not your political figure here. He is not going to win the election. When you look at Timothy, he's uncertain many times of himself. He's timid. He has to be reminded that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. He's not saying that to him just to say it. It means something. It's reality. And I want you to see in this passage, beginning in verse number 3, I thank God whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. Now why? Why does he do this? Because in verse 4, he's reminded of him as he remembers his tears, he's filled with joy, so that in verse 5, I'm reminded of your sincere faith. There's nothing wrong with this faith. It is a complete saving faith at this point. And I want you to see that it has had this impact of faith that first dwelt in your grandmother Lois, passed on generationally, then to his mother Eunice, and now also to Timothy. I want you to point out as well that more than likely Timothy's father was a Greek, probably not a believer. We're not certain completely about all the details. But even in a broken setting of this nature, the gospel has not lost its effectiveness. The gospel's going forward. We can rest in that. There's joy in that. And I want you to see how he describes this. A faith that dwelt. We struggle with this today because, you know, we've got goofy songs from my childhood. George Michael's, "You Gotta Have Faith, Faith, Faith." You know, oh, what a nightmare. And it's just, you know, well, and then it has bled into the church with this. Well, it's because you didn't trust God enough and believe in him that your miracle wasn't given to you, or that he didn't answer your prayer. What nonsense. This comes through what we would call a prosperity-aligned gospel, that, in other words, I have to muster up enough and fill myself with this, and somehow in myself, I want you to say, it is the epitome of self-justification. There is nothing glorying in this of Jesus. I want you to see in this passage, guard the good deposit. I love that phrase. You and I need to see ourselves as this clunky old cup. Now, I don't know about you. My morning routine, I like my coffee. And I have all kinds of cups. Some of them are new. Some of them are old. And I often will dig to the back of the cabinet where my wife has buried my ugly cup because I want it. I'm a clunky vessel. You're a clunky vessel. It's not up to you and I, but it's what's been deposited in you and me, a faith. And it has dwelt first in grandma, then it has dwelt in mom, and now, Timothy, it dwells in you. Does that make sense? Now, is Timothy at this point got everything going for him? Absolutely not. Look with me. Immediately after he gets done saying this in verse number 6, "For this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God." Now, what we see here is Paul and Timothy had been together. Paul had laid hands on him as an apostle and said, "I give to you this gifting." And more than likely, looking at the context, it is in this gifting of pastoring. And I want you, Timothy, to fan this flame. I want this to come alive in you. Because why is he saying this? Because obviously it needs to a little bit more. You can see this kind of like a job review at this point. Get busy, Timothy. And notice what he says. He reminds him, God's not given us a spirit of fear, Timothy, but of power and of love and self-control. And so look at verse number 8. "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me." He's worse off than Ivanka is right now. He's a prisoner. And sharing his sufferings. Oh, you would say, some today would say, "He must not be full of faith." Fool. Look at the text. "I'm sure that this sincere faith now dwells in you as well." Now, we'll get to what that faith is. But I want you to see that faith at this point is not something that you and I muster up. If we look at faith in that light, we have decimated what we've read earlier together in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." I'm thankful for my childhood where we sang songs like, speaking, "Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. I'm thankful for songs that it's by grace and grace alone that I live, so that I can leave and continue to hear those songs, put them on my phone. By the way, that song is by a group called Modern Post. I think Citizens and Saints has done another version of it as well. Look them up. Listen to it. I love how that song comes to the end, as we'll see this morning. I will slay my sin. I will kill my sin by grace and grace alone. It's not that we just sit back and there's nothing that we're doing. We are growing in Christ. Well, there are works for us to get to that we'll see in a moment. But what we're talking about here at this point is this. Timothy, there is nothing that you can do to add to your salvation. It has been entrusted. It has been deposited in you. It dwells in you, and it is a sincere faith. Even though you are fearful, even though you need to be reminded of the gift that I've given you, even though you need to be reminded that I am the one suffering and you're affiliated with me, jump in with me, buddy. And notice what he says to him. Verse 12, Paul is saying this to Timothy. He's wanting osmosis to happen here, and he wants to hear, just like we want to hear our kids repeat us, he wants to hear Timothy repeat him. And he says this, "For I know whom I have believed." Say it with me, Timothy. That's right. "And I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me." Now, Timothy, follow the pattern of the sound words you've been heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. And by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. There is no question here in this, Timothy. Hang on, buddy. You are right now really doubting about this Jesus thing. You're really struggling because I'm in prison and you're afraid that you're going to be next in prison. Timothy, you got to overcome your personal weaknesses. You're a little timid and shy, buddy. You better be careful because you might not make it into the pearly gates. You don't hear any of that in this text, do you? Timothy knows that it's completely, as Paul's been teaching him, by faith and faith alone. Well, why is this idea of faith alone so important? Not only in the time of Paul, and if you want to hear more about this, I commend to you the class that is going on right now in the book of Romans, because it will get into more greater depth on this, what we're going to talk about today, called justification. I'm only going to skim the surface. You'll spend weeks upon it. And you need to rehearse this and understand it. One of the key things, that edge that I was speaking of earlier, that we need to walk on is understanding what does justification by faith alone mean. And that's what we're talking about this morning. How did Timothy know that what he had, he was declared right in the standing of God? And how have we gotten to where we are today? Where we will sometimes say, well, I need to add my works to it, or on the other side, I somehow have to self-justify myself and work my faith up in some form. Both of those are falling into the ditches off the road. What we have to see here is this. God has helped us to bring us to saving faith through Jesus Christ alone, by his word alone, and it's by faith alone. There's nothing that you and I can add to it in works. There's nothing that you and I can add to it in faith. There was not a time that the church just kind of like flipped a light switch throughout history and got to a point where they began to deny that Christianity, being a child of God, is by faith alone. It happened gradually. It happened over time. Until the time of the reformers, particularly as we've been talking of Martin Luther. What took place is, as the Bible was translated, the one translation that was widely used of Jerome's Vulgate into the Latin, for the word that we say of justification, the word that in Greek is dikaiosune, they translated using the word that we get justification from, justificare. And it had this unfortunate meaning to it of making righteous, of making yourself right with God. And so as time went on, what crept into this was this idea that I have been made right with God, but now there's also this internalization of things that I have to begin to work and cooperate with God for this justification to hold its own in my life. And we get to Martin Luther, and what is he so concerned about at first is indulgences. Because what has taken place in this time is, if I didn't get to the point where I had made good with not only being made right with God, but then keeping it right, and I'll get to explain more of that in a moment, then what will happen is I have to go to a place where I'll be purged of the remaining sins that I have, hence called the area of what they now call purgatory. And there I could spend up to a couple hours until my sins are paid for, or I could be there for eternity paying for all my sin. Or if I offended God and did a mortal sin, even though I had been justified, I could lose my justification and die and go straight to hell. This is what was taking place in the time of Martin Luther and the teaching of the church. And Martin Luther in particularly was concerned with them selling these pieces of paper that came off the Gutenberg press first and foremost and saying, have this piece of paper and there will be a way by you buying this that you can have some of those sins purged off your list so you spend less time in purgatory, and you can also buy these for people that are your family. And in fact, if you really love your parents and your grandparents, you'll buy one of these for them as well. Luther then began to write the 95 Theses. Questions that he said we need to have a conversation about. 95 questions. And out of that grew this understanding as Luther and the rest of the reformers began to work through this in particular. They began to say, whoa, wait a minute. We've gotten this all wrong. Because what took place also during the Reformation was that they went now not only just to the translations that they had of the Latin Vulgate, they were now going back to the Greek text of the New Testament, and they read, this doesn't say made right. This is that they've been counted right. They've been reckoned right. They've been declared right. Whoa. This changes everything. Because now what's taking place in my life is I recognize there's not something that I'm doing along with God that he made me right and that I continue in this state. And then if I'm a good person and don't die with any mortal sins on my conscience, then I will at least go to purgatory so that I'll eventually be in heaven. It had gotten this convoluted. You say, how did it get there? Well, the process kind of looks like this, and you even see it today. The way that it's understood within Roman Catholicism that a person, first of all, receives justification is through the instrument of their baptism. At their baptism, they are infused with the righteousness of God. This righteousness is then given to them, and then as they go along, they have to continue to work it and cooperate with it. It's there in them. And as time goes on, there's so much more detail that I could add to this, but for sake of time, I keep it simple. The argument of the reformers was, if you want to know this, was instead of being righteousness infused in us, it's imputed to us in Jesus. This is still the key area where there's disagreement in, by the way. That's the key, what we would call the imputation of Christ, is where the disagreement is between Roman Catholics and Protestants. It is unkind for us to say that Catholics believe that salvation is by works and that we think it's only by faith and there's never any works. we can sit and we can make straw men of each other, and that's not going to be helpful. What's understood, though, is then, as this goes along, then I have now been infused with the righteousness of Christ. It's now for me to guard this deposit, if you will, and make sure that I don't commit a mortal sin. What's a mortal sin? Breaking one of the Ten Commandments, which is all talked about also in the seven deadly sins, which means that I know that I'm doing is wrong, and I willfully and intently do it. That's a mortal sin that removes the justification that I had had, and now I need to be re-justified. Well, you'd say, well, maybe I need to go back to baptism. No. That's where the other sacrament of penance now comes in. And so now that I have to show my penitence for what I have done willfully and knowingly, and which often includes going to confession. And here's where the problem comes. It's not in confessing your sins to one another. There is something very healthy about Christians, as it says in James, confessing your faults to one another. That's not our problem, folks. It's not even a problem for a person who's a pastor or a priest to remind us, listen, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. You need someone on your side telling you the blood of Jesus Christ will do its work and you are forgiven. But what then comes along with this then is then these works that are added into it, say these many Our Fathers, Hail Marys, give alms, whatever else that you could put into this, that's how I gain back my justification and I maintain it. This is where Martin Luther and the Reformers come in. And they recognize, if it makes sense to you now, this is why Martin Luther would sit in the monastery and whip himself trying to remove sin from his life because he was aggravated of his mortal and his venial sins, thinking that they are going to send me, I would die and maybe end up in hell. You can see that in the movie Martin Luther. It portrays it very well. And then he comes to the point, the just shall live by faith. Go with me in a couple places in the Bible to help you see this more clearly. I'm going to stay out of Romans simply because Wayne is covering that in his class, and I don't want to contradict him. Titus 3. The book right after 2 Timothy. We're going to be in this text next week, but I want you to see. Verse 4, But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness. Okay, there's nothing that you can add to your salvation. But according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that, and this is why we're going to be at this in grace alone next week, and so I will not explain this passage this week, so that being justified, in other words, declared right by God, by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. It is by faith alone. Let's go to the passage that we read earlier, and this is the second one, Ephesians. If you go back a couple books of Paul's letters, if you see Philippians, go back one more. If you've gotten to Galatians, you're too far, or Corinthians, turn right again. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Now, what's the gift? The salvation, the grace, the faith. Does that make sense? All of it. There's nothing that you have, in other words, raised up, okay, I've heard this message, now I've got to muster up the faith, the courage to believe it, We're going to talk about what is true faith here in a moment. But what we see here is this is all a gift. Verse 9, not a result of works, so that no one can boast. And so on either side, whether I think I'm going to add to what Jesus has done for me so that I can merit a righteousness, or that I can somehow muster up enough to believe in the righteousness of Christ on my own and make less of the cross because it's about me and my faith, I've missed the whole point. What is being said here is this. It is a gift of God, and if we were to go up earlier, verse number 4, like we sang in that song, Grace and Grace Alone, but God being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. The gospel brings life to us. It helps us to see, I was lost, but now I'm found. And so I run to Christ. I want to be found in him. And it doesn't matter how big at that point it is. And so this is why Jesus said, if you have the faith of even a mustard seed, it's enough. It's not the quantity here. It's what this faith is in. It's in Jesus Christ and his sacrificial death below for you. Because what happens here is, coming back to this now, understanding being justified by faith, what is taking place here is you are being declared right before God. You're being declared, because of Jesus, holy and perfect in his sight. You don't need Ivanka's wear to make you. She is trumped by Jesus. Jesus clothes us in his righteousness because we've been declared right before God. And even though we are still in our sins, God says, I've paid completely through my son, the sin bearer, for their sins. And it's not this future purgatory, it's future heaven. Because I've been made right with God, declared right with God, and will be made right with God. Remember I said I need to correct myself? I got to do it right there. I will be made right one day before him, holy and perfect. But right now, I am a sinner saved by God's grace. Now, where do works come into this? Because this is where the disagreement is. We have been saved by faith alone, but not alone to faith, if that makes sense. We have been saved by faith alone, but just not to faith. James, the brother of Jesus, put it this way, show me your faith by your works. In other words, if faith has truly taken root in a person's life, and you're in my life, there is going to be a change, a transformation of work in us. And we have this, we have three varying views now that we could look at it this way. Number one is we could look back at what it was we were speaking of, the Roman Catholic viewpoint. And I don't mean to belittle, by the way, Roman Catholicism. I'm just showing these distinctions where it would be said salvation, if I were to make a formula, would be faith plus works equals salvation. And we would say, no, it's faith, and some would go this way, equals salvation without works. There's a lot of people running around today with cheap grace. The old term that we used to call them was carnal Christians. I can trust in Jesus as my Savior and live my life however I want to because I've been saved. No, you can't. The work of God in our hearts changes us and transforms us. That is known old school as antinomianism. You're against the law. You're saying I can just do whatever I want to. That is as heretical as well. It is not faith plus works equals salvation. It is not faith equals salvation minus works. But it's this. Faith equals salvation, and the result of that salvation will be plus works. Look at Ephesians 2:10. Immediately after he gets done saying this, do you see the fine line now that we're walking? Verse 9 said, not by works, lest anyone should boast. But look at verse 10, now the fine line. We are his workmanship. Who's done the work in us? Jesus Christ. Now notice what it says. We've been created in Christ Jesus for what purpose? Good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. There will be a change and a transformation in our life. And the result of that will be the faith alone that brought me to salvation will bring the fruit of works in my life. Can I speak very clearly to us this morning? There's nothing that you and I can do this morning to add to the atoning sacrifice of Jesus. He does not need your help. It is not Christ in you alone to salvation. It is Jesus Christ alone. And do not ever cheapen Jesus to think that you can add one little mite to his mighty work for you and for me. You need to look at Jesus and you need to say, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. He's done it all for me. On the other hand, it cannot be in our minds to say, well, Jesus paid it all and I just live however I want to. We never see that within Scripture. We are a new creation. We are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works. There will be a change and transformation. And can I say to you today, if there is in some form you're believing in God, but that belief has not taken root and made changes and transformation in your life, then you need to consider what it is you truly have believed. And so I end with us thinking about what is faith. It's so interesting that if you have your bulletin on the back, providentially, it's the question from the Heidelberg Catechism this week, and it's also going to be on the slide here in a moment. What is faith? True faith, question 21. I want you to see, and you can underline on the back if you want, there's three things that have been held to historically what true faith is going to be. Number one, true faith is not only a sure knowledge. In other words, there is going to be information that you need to know. Does that make sense? There is something that you have to know. Secondly, by which I hold as true. The old word that we used to use for this is assent to it. Not only do I know it, but I agree, I assent to it that it's true. I agree. Yes, that's right. Okay? I hold as true all that God has revealed to us in Scripture so that we get to. It is also then a wholehearted trust which the Holy Spirit creates in me by the gospel that God has freely granted not only to others but to me also forgiveness of sins, eternal righteousness, and salvation. These are gifts of sheer grace granted solely by Christ's merit. Faith will look like this. There will be something that you know. What has God done? We need to know him. That's why, as we said a couple of weeks ago, when we were talking about God's word alone, there's nothing that I can study better than his word. I need to know his word. I need to know him more and more. Like we see in Philippians 3, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and share in his sufferings. There's a lifetime, there's an eternity to know him more and more. Do not think that just because you know the basics that you know enough. You need to be growing in the faith. That deposit that's been entrusted will develop, even though it's the size of a mustard seed at the beginning. So that you can agree with it. You should have this kind of attitude. Jesus, today I'm going to read your word, and I know you're reading it with me, and I hear your voice as I read it. And there's nothing wrong, by the way, of reading God's word out loud. I love to do that. I find such grace in it. As I read his word out loud to myself, and I hear these things, I can say, yes, that's true. Yes, I believe it. I agree. And I have to often pray a prayer like this. there's anything right now that I believe that is false, give me the grace to see it as wrong so that I can believe what is true. And then I'd commit myself to it. I trust and I rest in Him. Faith alone saves us. There's going to be a day that you and I will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And it'll be like we saw at the end of the Sermon on the Mount last year. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? And your name done all these wondrous works? And he will say to them, depart from me, I never knew you. I want to tell you, there's going to be a lot of religious people. They're going to be denied access to the throne of God. Why? Because they have not, what's missing there in the Sermon on the Mount is faith in the gospel. Jesus, I believe that you died and did everything necessary. You paid for my sins. Now, I want you to see also as a result of this, everything else that falls out of this is contingent upon justification. Number one, that you have been adopted into the family of God. If there's no justification, you're not his child. You've not been adopted. Where does sanctification take place? On the other side, it was sanctification was always part of my process of becoming a Christian. Now sanctification is part of this process of me growing and slaying my sin and serving God and pursuing Him. All of these things flow out of this. And so I encourage you, my faith has found a resting place, not in device or creed. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. What we need to be able to say, my righteousness is filthy rags. All my works are rubbish, like we're memorizing in Philippians 3. I count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ and be found in him. So I commend to you two things this morning. Number one, rest in the accomplished work of Jesus. If you're here today and you think you're on some kind of rat race and you're adding to his works, there's nothing that you need to do except what he has done. Secondly, if you think there's something that you're doing and believing and mustering up a measure of faith, stop. Rest in what you know and agree with and trust. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that Jesus has done everything necessary for our righteousness. He is perfectly clothed and clothes us perfectly. Thank you that we're declared to be right before you, even as sinners yet. We pray, God, that you would cause us to rejoice in you and your provision. Forgive us when we think that we need to add something to you, Jesus, that you're not enough. Cause us to rest in you and the work that you've done, the deposit that you've entrusted to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.